I started a new series, and it was called, we entitled it, The Majesty and the Power of God's Names. And I'm going to take my time on this series because it's really going to help us in a whole lot of different areas of our Christianity. And the main goal is for us to be able to get to know the Lord better, to grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior. We want to develop in this church, we want to develop mature, growing Christians. We don't want a bunch of spiritual infants. In the book of Corinthians, there was a lot of problems in that church. And Paul the Apostle addressed the church and he said, man, there's murmuring, there's complaining, there's griping, there's division in that church, there's immorality in that church. He said, at a time when you should be eating meat, you're still drinking milk. And there was all kinds of sexual immorality and all kinds of things. Some people, the church wasn't an organized, united church. He said, some people say they're of Paul, some of Apollos, some of Cephas, all this kind of nonsense. And Paul's addressing the church, and then he talks about, one, they need to mature, they need to grow, and you see that trait in the Corinthian church. And so it's very important. We've set out for a number of years to build a strong, thriving, growing church that where Christians are maturing. And we have a lot of people that have come that came through our homes that were messed up on drugs, and now they're pastors in our church. Now they're ministers. Now they're leaders. Now they're married. I can look around and see a lot of you that are sitting out there today. I remember when you were in the home. And now you're married, you own your own home. Can I get a witness? You're blessed, you have a family. Hello, come on somebody, right David, hey? I so many of us, and we're maturing. So the goal and the desire that we have is to see you become everything that God has called you to become and do what God has called you to do, to be and do. There's nothing more important than that. Nothing will ever satisfy you and fulfill you like when you're in God's perfect will. Can I get a witness? Amen. Can I ask you guys some questions today? I'm going to do it anyways. Have you ever been out of, just think about it. You don't have to answer unless you want to. Have you ever been out of God's will? Have you ever been in a place in your life where you felt dry? You ever been there? There's nothing more fulfilling, nothing more satisfying than being in the center of God's perfect will. Can I get a witness for anybody that knows what I'm talking about? There's nothing like that. There's no greater fulfillment. You see, God created us. You know, it's interesting because it says in the Bible, it says in the New Testament, Romans, it says that God put eternity in the hearts of men. What that means is that God created mankind. That's why. Why do you think, I'm going to lay a foundation here, then we're going to begin. Why do you think in every civilization, from the rainforests in the Amazon to the jungles of Africa to unexplored places in Brazil and every type of people throughout the world, they worship some type of deity. They have some type of higher being that they worship. The Greeks were polytheistic in their beliefs. They had which means multiple gods, the god of the sun, god of the moon. Because God put eternity in the hearts of men. In other words, you'll never fully be content or satisfied until you have a relationship with the living God that loves you and created you. Can I get a witness? Now, here in Christianity, we understand and we know that. And so today I want to talk to you as we begin this series and we continue on this series and I begin this part two. And we're going to be going through all the names of God. And I'm going to be laying a foundation and I'm going to be going over things. And because repetition is the mother of all learning, and I want us to grow. And we're going to look at the names of God, not only the eight compound names. Down the road, I'm going to bring you to the New Testament. And I'm going to show you how the Bible says in Hebrews 8:6 how Jesus has established a new covenant, and it is established on better promises. That's what the Word of God says. And so I'm going to show you how the eight compound names of God with the word Jehovah on it, how they fit into the eight things that Jesus Christ does for us in this life. And we're going to take a look at all that down the road. But before we do, we have to understand this. There's over over 80 compound names for God, describing God in the Bible, especially in the Old Testament. Over 80. And it's profound. Why would God want to do that? Because he wants to show us that there's so many different, he's multifaceted, there's so many dimensions, he's multidimensional. In other words, God wants to, every situation you'll ever face in life, God revealed himself in a certain way to meet a need. Because I'm going to tell you something, if there's anything I know, I don't know a whole lot of things. But I want to tell you this, I do know you're going to go through some stuff in this life. You guys, can I get a witness? You're going to go through some tragedies, some heartaches. You're going to hit some, you're going to have some times when you're going to question and you're going to say, God, where are you? Even if you don't verbalize it, you may think it in your mind. Does anybody here know what I'm, what about you guys? There are going to come times in your life when you're going to be face to face with some problems, some situations, some things that even the control freak can't control. Some things you can't handle. You need God's strength. You need God to show up. You need God to reveal another dimension of himself to be able to help you through that situation. Do you understand what I'm talking about? That's why we're going through this. So we can understand God and everything about God. Let's look at some scriptures. Amen? We're going to bounce off of what we did last week. Let's go ahead and go to Psalms 8 real fast. We got to move fast. And today I'm going to try to get as far as I can. Okay, Psalms chapter 8. Let's put it up, please. We're going to reiterate and go over that. I'm not going to take time. We broke it down last time, so we're not going to do that. We're just going to read through it. Is it up? Yep. Psalms chapter 8, starting verse 1. O Lord. Now notice the word Lord. Capital L, O, capital R, capital D. Very important. Somebody say very important. Every time you see capital O, capital L, O, R, D, in capital letters, it's the word Jehovah. We're going to go through that word, just break that word down in, later on down in the series. Anyways, he says, O Lord, and then notice the next one, our Lord. Now look at the next word, Lord. L, O, not capital, R, not capital, D, not capital. That is the word Adonai. A lot of people, the reason why he uses that and it's translated in English, O Lord, our Lord, is because a lot of Christians only live in that first Lord, Jehovah. Now, whenever God wants to use the name Jehovah, it's because he wants to build a relationship with someone. The word Jehovah, and we're going to take a whole, probably a half of one of my services on a Sunday and talk about that word, because it deals with relationship, it deals with friendship, it deals with commitment. Actually, it's a picture of marriage, the intimacy of marriage, because God wants intimacy with us. God doesn't just care. If you know, Christians sometimes come up to me and they say, I don't feel close to God. I feel far from God. You ever heard somebody say that? Have you ever heard somebody say that? Have you ever been counseling leader or Christian? Or have you ever said that? I don't feel close to God. I don't feel, for some reason, I feel like God's far away from me. It's not God. It's you and me. It's we're not taking the time that maybe we once took, reading, praying, enjoying his presence, turning off that Babylonian idol box every now and then, called the TV, getting away to someplace quiet and just sitting in the presence of the Lord and put on some worship, huh? Quieting your mind, quit asking God for stuff. See, some Christians' prayer life consists of asking, 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 asking. Gimme, 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 gimme. God, do this for me. God, I need that. God, save this. God, provide the finances. God, heal my body. Lord, open this door. And even you might even throw in a couple of, Lord, I thank you for the breakthrough. I thank you that I'm the head and not the tail, and I have finances coming. I thank you, I'm whole. It's just another form of asking, which is the right way, and there's nothing wrong with that. But sometimes you just need to sit, stand, walk, and just enjoy the presence of God and not ask for nothing. Now, I know we got some single people and some younger people here, but let me talk, and the married couples can relate to this. If the only time that you start being nice and friendly when you're with your wife is because you're and if the wife says, oh, I know what you want. Sometimes you just got to say, I just want to hug you. You got to throw them off a little bit, you know what I'm saying? No. That's not what I want. I want to just hold your hand and be close to you, baby. Liar, liar, liar. It's okay. It's okay. Making a few deposits because withdrawals will come. Because, like we were talking about in the marriage retreat, intimacy is more than sex. And sex is not a sin. There's nothing wrong for unless it's outside of marriage. In marriage, it's holy and pure. But outside of it is wicked and perverted and wrong. Wrong. It's just wrong. You cannot sugarcoat it. And so the importance of God, and that's why he uses these two phrases here. So every time you see the word Lord in capitals, you know that that's Jehovah. What it's saying to you, look at what it's saying to you is relationship. What I look for, what I'm longing for, what I want from you, God's saying is I want a connection with you. I want to know you and I want you to know me. Then we go on. Man, we got to move fast. How majestic! Woo! Don't you love that? How majestic is your name? We looked at all that, what that means in all the earth. No other name like you, God. Then let's skip up to verse 3. When I consider the heavens, we don't even got to go into all that. We already did. The work of your fingers. Imagine with this finger he created everything you and I see. Just this finger, not even his hand. It's profound, huh? The work of your fingers, Lord, not even just, you know, it's really heavy. Anyways, what is man that you are mindful of him? And the son of man that you care for him? And then to skip down to verse 9, he says, O Lord, our Lord, here it is again. O Jehovah, our Adonai. How majestic is your name in all the earth. And we're going to look at that. And then Proverbs chapter 18, let me read it to you. 18:10 says, I think we can put it up on the screens. The name of the Lord is a, say it with me. Come on, say it. Oh, my God. Say it. A strong tower. The righteous run and are safe. The power of God's names. So beautiful. There's nothing like it. Somebody say amen. Amen. Now, real quickly. Real quickly. We talked about the importance of names. How names mean something. And it's very, very important. I said last week, and let me say it again. One of the goals of this series, and I'm going to give you a new goal this morning, is to teach you the names of God because it reveals his attributes, his character, his nature, and so that we can have a deeper trust and deeper relationship with God. Names are important. We talked about last time. Names provide identification. Your name is the gateway to who you are. It's the gateway to a relationship. We talked about when you want to get to know somebody, you ask them their name. It's very, very important. And so we looked at all that kind of stuff. Names have substance and significance. Very, very important. And so does God. Throughout the Bible, there's over 80 compound names for God. God wants us to understand, and God wants us to know him intimately, to live in relationship with him. And each of the compound names, they mean something. Jehovah Tiskanu, it means the Lord who will set you apart from the world, the Lord who sanctifies you, who covers you and separates you. Jehovah Shalom, it means the Lord is peace, or the peace of God will keep you in all circumstances. You know, you could feel the presence and the peace of God. Sometimes tragedy will happen and you'll still feel the peace of God. Can I get a witness in the house? Amen? Something where everybody else is going crazy and you can have the peace of God. Come on. And then Jehovah Shammah means that the Lord is present. In other words, no matter what happens in life, God is always there. No matter where you go, it's like oxygen, like air. You can go anywhere in the world, and when you get off the plane and you get there, you sense the presence of God. I have been in South America, and I've been in South Africa, and I felt the presence of God. I've been in Europe, and I've been in Mexico, and I felt the presence of God. Come on, somebody. He's everywhere. And as you get older, you're going to need Jehovah Rapha, the Lord who heals you. Anybody here need a healing? And then you're going to need, well, this might not relate to anybody, but maybe a couple of you. There will come times in your life when you're going to need Jehovah Jireh. Oh, stop it. Did I hit a nerve? There are going to come times in your life where you're going to need, have you ever been in a tough situation when you needed a financial miracle? Nobody here. I'm sorry. Have you ever, let me ask you a question. Is there anybody here that could use more money in your life? Just one guy in the home, amen. One guy in the home, that's it. See, that's the problem with our church. We have a lot of millionaires. We have 300 and some millionaires here today, this morning? Is there anybody here that could use some more money? Now, why do you not respond? Do you think money is evil? Do you think having money is wrong? What does the Bible say about money? No, it doesn't say money is evil. The what of money is evil? Okay, you know there's actually four. Four Greek words for the word love. There's the agape, the God kind of love, right? There's the eros love, where we get the word erotic, sexual, selfish, self-gratifying. There's the phileo. We get the English word Philadelphia, brotherly love. It's a conditional love. I love you because you love me. But if you stop loving me, I might stop loving you. That's Philadelphia. That's not agape. Agape loves that somebody could hurt you, talk bad about you, and you still love them, and not only do you love them, you do your best to bless them. That's when you really have maturity in your life. When you go out of your way to be good to somebody, even when you know they're not good to you and they've done things to hurt you, that's when you become a true Christian. That's when you become a mature Christian. Hello, come on! Well, that's good preaching, whether you like it or not. The love of money. The love of money. It should be translated the lust of. Because that's really what he's talking about. The lust of money is evil. A longing for, in spite of who you gotta hurt, step over. A selfish type. I know a lot of good Christians that are millionaires that are a blessing to the kingdom of God. And I've been praying. God gave me a promise a long time ago. And I remind God all the time. Lord, remember your word to your servant. God promised, he said, I'm going to cause some people in your congregation, son, to become wealthy. I'm waiting for God to make some of you wealthy, man. He told me it's going to happen. And then he also promised me and told me, I'm going to bring people that are going to help finance your vision, because I've put a lot of vision inside of you, son. You're a visionary. So some of you need to get busy, start giving so God can give it to you, because he'll never give it to you unless he can get it through you. Maybe you're holding up the blessing of God from your life. He'll never give it to you if he can't get it through you. If you don't let go of what's in your hand. See, let me tell you something. You can claim God's prosperity and God's blessing till the day you die. But if you're not a faithful tither and a giver, you ain't never going to be blessed. Because you're going. I'm just going to say it. God doesn't go against this. You do. You do. I do. Let's just keep it real up in here. You and I go against this. For different, how do we go against God's word? When we don't live out what it says? We hold back intentionally. We hold back because of certain motives. Sometimes that's why God says he searches the intent and the motive of every man's heart. He weighs the motives. Sometimes we think we're right. You could be right, but you can be sincerely. You could be sincere, but sincerely wrong. Sincerity is not a prerequisite for the blessings of God. So what we need to do is live God's word so that God can be everything he wants to be inside of our lives. Amen. Come on, somebody. Jehovah Nissi, the Lord is my banner in fight. And he's also our shepherd. Amen. Now, let's get to the rest of it today. The Hebrew word Jehovah is translated, like we talked about, L-O-R-D in capitals. To distinguish it, now listen, very important. Every time when you're reading the Bible and you see capital L-O-R-D in capitals, it's the Hebrew word Jehovah. To distinguish it from another Hebrew word that is also spelled L-O-R-D. And these words are two different. I'm going to take a half of a Sunday and break down this word. And it's the Hebrew word Adonai. Everybody say Adonai. Adonai. Now I'm going to tell you something. This is the truth. This is the truth. The Bible says, let God be true, but every man a liar. Can I guys ask you guys a question? I'm going to ask you, you guys could just relax for a second. This group of good-looking Christians right here, or good-looking people right here. From right here? That's right, amen. Looking good this morning, brother. Come on. You don't look a day over 20. Which brings me to my point. Man lies sometimes. But it sure feels good. From right here to right here. And then we'll get to you guys in a minute. Have you ever told a lie? You don't have to say nothing. Just sit there and look innocent. Sit there and look whole. Have you ever lied in your lifetime? You're lying right now, sister. Okay, in your lifetime. Well, let's just talk about we're in the year 2016. Have you been dishonest or untruthful in 2016? Venus looks so holy, I don't even want to ask her. It's impossible for her. But everybody else besides Venus, all the rest of us, think about what I'm saying. The Bible says that God is truth. See, here's my point. Here's my point. We strive to live in integrity. We strive to have character. I've made it a goal for all these years of my life to try to be a man of integrity and character. Those two words, Lord, Lord, translated the same way, but one of them's capitals. The capitals is Jehovah. You say in English, I was listening to rabbis doing sermons on the Old Testament, just straight rabbis that are not messianic rabbis, which means they don't believe in Jesus. They're the Old Testament still. And then I have a couple of books and commentaries written by messianic rabbis that are saved, but they're still rabbis of synagogues. They have messianic congregations where they're all Jewish, they're Hebrews, but the rabbi has gotten saved and experienced Jesus Christ as Messiah. And I was listening to their sermons and looking for the way they pronounce these words, which is not important because we're English, it's different. But the way they pronounce the word Al, capital O, capital R, capital D, which is Jehovah, which we say Jehovah, but it's really not. They pronounce it Yehovah. And like Elohim, we say Elohim. And it's hard for me because I'm not Hebrew. But my point is this. This is the most important part. Everybody here, if you give your life to Jesus Christ and you become a Christian, He reveals Himself to you with the capital L, capital O, capital R, capital D, Jehovah. We say Jehovah. L, O, R, D, not capital, is the word, the Hebrew word Adonai. Adonai. Not everybody knows God as Adonai. Everybody knows God as Jehovah, which is friend, Lord, Savior. Even if you're not close to Him, He's close to you. The difference is Adonai is when a person is 100% totally surrendered to God and He is the complete Lord of your life. Does that mean you're without sin? Does that mean you're without sin? Of course not. Come on. Who? For all have sinned to come short of the glory of God. Even Venus, I'm sure she committed a sin in the last 5 years. George, I'm sure she has. What do you say? George, what do you say? Don't be afraid. He said, I ain't saying nothing. I got to ride home with her. That's either a fearful man or a smart man. Okay, now watch this. How do you know if he's Lord of your life? How do you know if he is Adonai in your life? I'm gonna break that whole word down and show you where it's used in the Bible and everything and how we can know down the road. But just for today, is that old saying is so true. If he's not Lord of all, he's not Lord at all. He desires complete lordship. He says in Revelations, I wish that you were either hot or cold, but when you're lukewarm, I want to spit you out of my mouth. He tells the church at Ephesus, he says, repent, remember your, and then he tells another one, he says, remember from the height which you have fallen. In other words, you've come back to a place where you're not letting me be the Lord of your life anymore. Then he says this, remember your first love to another church. Remember that? Remember your first love. That's when he's Lord of everything. You just want to please him and serve him. But after a while, you get comfortable with your salvation. And all of a sudden, you want to kind of be in charge. You and I. And we don't let him be the priority of our lives. Number one priority. Number one priority. Somebody say amen. Number one priority. Now, the word Jehovah, capital L, capital O, capital R, capital D, is the most frequently used word in the Old Testament. It's used 6,823 times. The first time it's used is in Genesis. You know the first name of God? You know the first name of God that is used in the whole Bible? As the Bible opens up? Let me get there real fast, and then I'm going to turn to our verse, and we're going to close. Because we're going to take care of some business this morning. We're going to talk to God. beginning. If something has a beginning, it means it's got to have an end. As far as you and I know, right? Hello, right? You have a beginning and the day will come, you're going to have an end. It's inevitable. God. The first description of God is a whole different word. It's the Hebrew word Elohim. Elohim. And it means all-powerful, almighty, great one. Watch this, though. And most people leave it out until I heard a messianic rabbi doing a teaching on this. And it means, it comes from these two Hebrew words. And one of the words, we get the English word judge. And what it means is in the beginning, the all-powerful, almighty Elohim, the great one, the unquestionable judge. In other words, you can't question his judgment on your life. You will not be able to stand before him and question him about nothing. But you will stand before him and he will question you about what you did with your life while you were here on this earth. Not for your sins if you're saved, but the Bema Seat of Christ is where Elohim comes into play. You know when you're going to know him as Elohim? And you know what's heavy about Jesus? Every one of these eight compound names about Jehovah. Remember, Jehovah means friendship, relationship. He's trying to, every time you see that word, he's trying to express he wants relationship. He wants connection with you. And then the other compound words, something that you're going to need in your life while you're living here on this earth. You're going to need a healer. You're going to need a provider. You know what I'm saying? But you're also going to know Jesus in all. Every one of those compound names describes something Jesus did while he was here on the earth, his life, his ministry. And you know when Elohim comes out in Jesus? At the Bema Seat of Christ. When you and I stand before him on the marriage supper of the Lamb, and we're not questioned about our sins because our sins are covered, but the Bible says we will receive rewards. He says, but some people are going to have some rewards that are going to be burned up. Doesn't it say that? How could they be burned up? What does it mean? That everything you did that wasn't God's perfect will for your life, everything you did that was to please you, yourself, everything you did, you put yourself on the throne of your life, and it wasn't really God's best, but he allowed it anyways, because sometimes you'll do some stuff, and it isn't God's perfect will, but he'll allow it for your life. Sometimes you could take a job or do something, and it's not God's best, but he'll allow it. How many of you have ever experienced God like that? You do something, but you know it's not God's best. Somehow you know you're making a mistake, but you'll do it anyways, because you want it. Then at the marriage supper of the Lamb, he says, it'll all come out. Everything we did, why we did it, our motives will be the judge. That's when we're going to know him, Jesus, as the unquestionable judge. Thank God, not judge for our sins. Somebody say amen. Talk to me, church. Woo, aren't you glad? Aren't you glad? Look at this screen right here. Yeah, that's right. I'm clapping too. Woo, come on. See this screen? See the screen? Can you imagine at the marriage supper of the Lamb when we all stand to give an account? If the Lord Jesus would play our life story of all of our failures, all of our evil thoughts, all of the things we did that were wrong? Huh? And I would say, Orlando, you really thought that? You filthy animal. Huh? Bishop, how did you even make it up here? Man, you talk about the grace of God. Woo, God. Are you sure he belongs here? Huh? No, but it ain't going to be like that. Somebody say thank you, Jesus. Right? Can I get a witness in the house? All right. Let's see where we're at. Okay. 27 minutes I've been speaking. I'm going to get ready to close. All right. Now, very important. Another reason why this series is very important is so that we can bring glory to God and enjoy Him in a personal way. But listen to what I'm going to tell you right now as I get ready to close. You will only enjoy your relationship to the Lord. Very important. Listen to me. You will only enjoy your relationship with the Lord and bring glory to God in proportion to how you know Him. The knowledge of God is more important. See, that's why I take time. I want to drive this stuff home. I don't care about speaking fancy cliches and doing flips and doing words and giving you eloquent speeches, because that doesn't build a church. I've been at this long enough to know that it takes God's word and the conviction of the Holy Spirit of God's word in your life that will bring change. To know Him, to know God is more important. Listen to me. Listen carefully now. Shut me out, but you can't shut Him out. The knowledge of God is more important than the knowledge of anything else while you're on this earth. Temporal knowledge is important. It's important. Listen, education, important. Career skills, important. But those are temporal. And you won't take them to eternity with you. Eternal is most important. To know Him. To know Him. To walk with Him. Our number one priority as God's people, as Christians, is to know our God, to experience Him intimately, to have intimate fellowship, intimate relationship with the God that loves us beyond what we'll ever know. I'm going to read a passage from John 17 to you this morning. In John chapter 17, verse 3, Jesus is saying, He says, John 17, 3 says, "Now this is eternal life. Now this is eternal life. That they may know you." He's praying. He's talking here and he's saying that they would know you, Father God. They would know you. That they would know you. That His people, Christians of the future, through all eternity, through all this earth realm and time, would know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. And then he goes on and he's praying this prayer and he's praying for the disciples, and it's so powerful and so profound. And then in verse 11, it says, "I will remain in the world no longer." His time had came. He says, "But they are still in the world. And I am coming to you, Holy Father. Protect them." Watch this. "Protect them by the power." Woo! "Protect them by the power of your name." He's saying, protect them. When they need a provider, you're going to be Jehovah Jireh. When they need a healer, you're going to be Jehovah Rapha. When they need a shepherd, when they need comfort and guidance, you're going to be Jehovah Raha. You're going to be the provider, the shepherd. You're God Almighty. There's times you're going to need them to be Elohim, Adonai, Lord of all. Protect them by your name, who you are, God. By the power of your name. But how are you going to experience that if you don't walk with Him, if you don't know Him, and you continue to live a shallow Christianity? Then that's the kind of experience you'll have with God, a shallow experience. And you can live your life, but one day, brother, one day, sister, You're going to stand before him and you're going to give an account. And then what are you going to tell him? If he had things for you to do and you didn't do them because you didn't want to do them, because it didn't line up with your pleasures and your priorities, you didn't be who he had called you to be because you didn't want to. You chased after what was temporal, and now the temporal has passed. And maybe you know the Lord and you got salvation, but you're going to be one of those ones that's described in the New Testament, that's described in the Bible, that says all their gifts have burned up. You'll be in the smoking section. Everything singed. Only what you do for Christ will last. Maybe you didn't do or be who he wanted you to be in him because it didn't fit in with your selfish pleasures. You weren't willing to give of your time, your talent, or your money because you came to a point that you wanted to put yourself before God. See, I'm going to tell you something. Me and my wife have been doing ministry for a long time. A lot of the pastoral team have been doing ministry for a long time. A lot of our top line leaders have been doing ministry for a long, long time. And we've given of our time, our talent, and our money. And we ain't done yet. We're a long way off. We got cities to conquer. We got countries to send people to. We got a world to reach. And not one of us is homeless. And not one of us, well, I'm not going to say that. I was going to say not one of us is skinny, but we're well fed. We're well blessed. And we don't cry. We don't complain. And we don't murmur. At least I don't. Do you? About giving 100% to God. Because he gave 100% to me. And he gave 100% to you. And that's when you know him as Adonai, Lord of all. And that's what he's looking for in our lives. Let's stand to our feet. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Begin to pray. Several altar calls. The first one is, don't get weary in well doing. What the enemy tries to do is get people to get weary in well doing. He used it on me many years ago. And I had a Jonah season in my life, and I tried to run from God. And I said, you know, The enemy sends different enemies after us, different demons at times to try to distract us, destroy us, hinder us, stop us, crush us, and destroy us. And I began to say, man, wait a minute here. I've been full-time ministry. I've been already at that point, I had already been a home director for about 4 years off and on, and well, 4 years plus. And I was working at the office. Almost 30 years ago, I was making $50 a week salary. I had a discipleship home, and I was raising a family. And God always supernaturally provided, and we never did without. But I allowed a spirit to come and try to lie to me that I needed to bless myself, and that I had been paying a price. And I began to look at other people and look at things, and I decided to step out of God's will and bless myself. So, you know, forget ministry. Forget all this. And without praying, I called this company, a vice president of this company I used to work for. I had started working after I came out of the home, and I was working there. And not every door that opens is God, and not everything that glitters is gold. And he said, sure, I'd love to have you back. Come next week, let's have a meeting. I didn't even pray about it because I didn't want to hear God's voice. And I left full-time ministry. I was there at the office as a young man, and I working full-time and overseeing all the homes and overseeing the life groups and preaching at the church. And I ran like Jonah, and I went to work and said, oh, I'm going to go back into the union. I took my withdrawal card so I could get back in. And sure enough, I started making good money. I started climbing the ladder. I was so empty. The new car I bought, I went out and bought a brand new car. First time in a long time, I actually had a savings account with a few thousand dollars, and it was climbing. I had a 401k. But I was the most empty, miserable person. One day, early in the morning, I had just got another promotion, and it meant that I was receiving 1% bonus of the profits that were coming every quarter when we did inventory. And this is way back in the early 80s. And I was on target to make about $90,000 that year, back in 85. Those same guys that are working, they're making $150 a year now, $150,000 plus, that were in my position, working down by the docks at the warehouse in the union. I stood there. I got there before the first shift, turned on all the lights, and I stood in the middle of the warehouse. I was getting everything ready because all the trucks would come, and we would send them, they would take stuff from the port here, we'd take it to our warehouse, and then we would ship it all over to different states. And we'd line up the different trucks and schedule them. And I stood there, and I began to cry. And I said, I'm empty, God, I'm miserable. I don't care about stinking this position and what I have. I'm empty. I'm so empty inside. I was not created to do. This is what I was created and put on this earth to do, work in a warehouse and die, grow old and die and be miserable. I looked at some of my supervisors, the bosses. They had been through 3-4 marriages. Some were alcoholics, cheating on their wives. These people. And then there's one guy that was a Christian. His whole thing was he'd go to church and give God a chump change on Sunday and then live his life. And I thought, he's going to stand before the Lord and give an account? God is not his first priority. There's got to be more. I can't. And I remember saying, God, I'm not going to run anymore like Jonah. I just came at the point I said, God, I'm sorry, God. My day off. The next day I went to the church office. I was going to talk to the pastor. He wasn't there. I was standing on the sidewalk, getting ready to walk to the parking lot to get to my car. A car drove up and they honked the horn, rolled down the window. It was a pastor friend of mine I grew up with. He said, "Joe, this morning I've had such a burden in my heart for you. I just can't shake it." And the Lord spoke to me and told me where I was at to leave and go straight over here right now. This is heavy. This is ordained of God. He said, "I want to take you to lunch." We got there, we sat down. And the first thing came out of his mouth, he said, "You're out of God's will. What are you doing? God has called you." I knew at that point I had to get back and give God my first priority. There's people that have gotten saved. Some of you here, you're our spiritual children. You've gotten touched in this church. You got delivered here. Some of you have gotten saved here and gotten married here. Some of you, you come and you receive God's word and you get blessed here because somebody answered the call. Your life is going to impact other people too, but you got to position yourself. God has to be first priority now. Jesus said this above all else. It's priority number one. Seek ye first. Not second, not last, not when you feel like it, not how you want. Seek ye first. Go after first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and everything will be given to you. I don't chase after money. I don't chase after car. I don't chase after material things, but everything I have, God has brought to me and blessed me because my priorities are right. I am a blessed man because my heart is right with God, and I could care less about that stuff. I don't go out caring about stuff. I like stuff just like everybody else, and I never go out chasing those things. Seek ye first the kingdom of God is right now. All these things. Well, you say, "Yeah, but Pastor, you're blessed." Yeah, I am blessed because I seek him. And everything I have, God's given to me. Everything I've ever desired. I wanted new patio furniture for the back where I meet with the Holy Spirit every day and I pray. And I had one of the brothers came and called me and said, "Hey, Pastor, I just was somewhere and I seen this patio furniture and I thought of you and I want to bring it over to your house. I'm going to bless you with this." All I did in my heart was say, "Lord, man, I want to be able to sit and study out here. Everything I have, I've had for 10 to 12 years." On Father's Day, a brother came up to me, a beautiful one of the ministers, and he said, "Pastor, you wear that same watch all the time." And he blessed me with two nice watches. I don't chase after stuff. Suits, I've given all my suits away over and over a bunch of times. You could go to my closet now. And I've gotten blessed with suits. Danny's blessed me with suits. Different of you here in this church. I don't chase after things. That's my wife. I don't go to the mall all the time. I don't chase after nothing. Everything I have, God's given to me. Because I don't lust after things. I long after God because he set me free when I was a good-for-nothing lowlife. What if it wasn't for him, I wouldn't even be here now. And I'm forever grateful. I want to make an altar call for those of you that may be weary and well-doing, or maybe you've been feeling and you haven't seen and reaped the blessing yet. I want to make an altar call for those of you that you're not putting him first in your life. Let's sing a song. I also want to make an altar. Come on, let's go ahead and sing. I want to make an altar call. If God has spoken to you in any way, I want you to come here to the altar quickly.
Is our God. Sing with me how great.
Maybe you need to make him the Elder on your life again. I don't know.
So we'll see how great, how great is our God. How great is our God. Sing with me. Our God, and so we'll see how.
Father, right now, come on, every hand lifted. Come on, just lift your hands. The surrenders to the Lord throughout this whole sanctuary, not just here at the altar. Lord, I pray for every man and woman in this place. I pray for a complete surrenderance to your will. Holy Spirit, you're the only one that can captivate a mind and a heart and draw people to you, Lord, at a deeper level. Lord, we want to make you first priority in our lives, to know you, just to know you. Paul the Apostle, your servant, said that I may know him, that I may know him, to know you, God. To walk with you like Enoch. It says he walked with you and he wasn't, for you took him. A picture of the intimacy of fellowship with you, Lord. Draw us closer. Let us be people whose hearts follow hard after you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Now, let me tell you something. See, it's not a one-time thing. It's a continued dying to self and letting him be the Lord of your life. And that's the secret to longevity and consistency. Just let him be the Lord of your life. If we can have, can you imagine if we had everyone or 80% of our church, we're about to have a second service, a whole different group of people will be in here filling this place up. Imagine how we could shake the world. How we can impact souls and people. Let's be all God's called us to be. Let's do everything God called us to do. Amen? Amen? Say amen. Let it be so. Praise the Lord. Amen. You can make your way back to your seats.